Matthew Wright. I'm the chief host of Our Collective Minds Radio. And again, it's my pleasure and an honor to welcome back Wendy Adams of Light Waves Radio back to our show here. Wendy's been on other ones and several other ones, and I've been on her show as well. And Wendy, are you there?
I'm here.
All right.
I'm
so we had a little malfunction there, but I got it straight. But to those who might not know you, go ahead and introduce yourself to them, if you don't mind.
Okay, I'll be happy to. My name is Wendy Adams, and I'm from Light Waves Radio over on lightwavesradio.com. And I'm currently doing 3 radio shows over there. It's the Wendy Adams Show on Wednesday. I do Night Waves on Friday with Jewel Throne, and a shout out to Jewel. I also work on Inner Circle, and we do those shows usually either me hosting it solo or with another co-host, Michelle Marr. So shout out to Michelle, and Jennifer Hansen's on there as well from time to time. So I got to say a shout out to her, everyone over there. Love you guys. Okay.
All right. That's good. That works. That works. Now, to those who might be new to this show and to Light Waves Radio and so forth, let me say this, that we, Wendy and I, both go by intuition once we're on the air. We rely on intuition on what to say. We don't pre-plan too much. We try to write out show descriptions pretty vaguely, because it's more important to trust intuition once you're on the air than to pre-plan something to the letter, and then intuition throws it off anyway. Once you're on the air, things go a different way. It's better just to roll with intuition. Now, we've had shows on here, and she's had shows on her channel where things went completely different directions than the description stated. But there are no mistakes in the universe. Everything happens for a reason. There are no coincidences. So we can roll with that. It's no problem. And one other thing I might mention here, for those who call in, we decided to implement a little rule here with this. We're going to, except in cases of extraordinary circumstances, we've implemented a 10-minute rule on calls, people calling in. We keep it 10 minutes or less unless there's extenuating circumstances that necessitates prolonging of the call. I just wanted to go ahead and state that as well. And, Wendy, go ahead and take the lead here. Let's see where intuition leads us tonight.
Absolutely, Matthew. I'm glad to help and to come in here first on it. I think that the important thing is to let them know that we are both very, very intuitive, and we're both mediums. We both have a lot of gifts and abilities. Many. I kind of think that we should kind of maybe talk a little bit about that.
I think that's a good idea, too. I sense that, too. Go ahead, start with yourself. Keep on going.
Okay. Absolutely.
Let me jump in real quick and say, that I've always, told Wendy I admire, her voice. She has the perfect radio voice, whereas I might sound like a surfer boy, a California surfer boy, as I like to put it, and some other people do. But go ahead, Wendy. I'm sorry. I just wanted to throw that in.
Well, thank you. That's a sweet thing to say. When you're talking with us, we both, Matthew and myself, actually do readings for people as well. The readings that I do the most are actually would be called like medium readings, because mediumship is one of my abilities, and I usually communicate with those who have passed on the most. And it's just kind of a preference for me, honestly. That's something that I prefer to do. I will do psychic readings as well, because, I mean, like, we should kind of explain. I mean, you know, really, both of us are clairvoyant, we're clairaudient, you know, clairsensitive. We both remote view. We do so many different things, and we have so many abilities that we've been blessed with. And, you know, one of the things that I wanted to say, Matthew, is let me ask you a question, if you don't mind.
No problem.
Whenever I'm on a show, people always ask me a couple of questions, and I thought, why not ask you these? When did you know that you had abilities?
Well, I mean, it goes back to me as a child, and realizing I remember like that as far back as I'm thinking like the second, third grade, even before then. I mean, even the littler, but I remember like one particular day where it all kind of hit me. It was, I believe it was in early third grade, and as a little kid, of course, and it hit me that like I don't think like these other people, like my classmates and my friends. I'm thinking like an adult here, you know, like I'm seeing things about them, you know, that they don't even see about themselves, and it's just coming to me. And at the same time, I'm going through other experiences, you know, on my own at that time. And, like, I'll never, like, you know, something else, like, you know, that comes far earlier than third grade. I remember being about 5 years old, 4 or 5 years old, and I can remember it to this very day. My parents were like arguing, and then they ended up talking about they were in an argument, and of course a lot of cuss words and whatnot, and then they were talking about sex after the argument. And at that age, I believe it was 4 or 5, like I clearly remember understanding it all, and then seeing like, you know, my own certain memories from the immediate past life before that come to me. My immediate past life, I died in 1926. That was the one before this one. And I already knew what all the cuss words meant, what all the sexual words meant, except I couldn't verbalize it, you know, physically verbalize it. And I saw, like, the past life stuff, and I recognized it for what it was, that this isn't, you know, there's no such thing as one life to live. There's infinite lives to live. And but it didn't really start hitting home. Like, I didn't especially really go after, like, using abilities to the max until around 2000, where, you know, circumstances of the universe, you could say, non-coincidental, quote-unquote, coincidences, as I termed them, like, all came about, you know, to put me in a position where the abilities were maximized and started gaining more and more. The more I used what I already had, like, the more new abilities came in, you know? And at that point, it was, I'd say around, you know, late 2001 where it really hit me, that I've got to use what I'm able to do all the time. And that's the purpose of my life. One of the main purposes is to use them, like, to learn from it, like, to teach others, to help others through them. Before that, I kept it to myself. Like, because of the way I was raised, if I had brought up some of the stuff I had seen, experienced as a little kid, you know, coming from a dysfunctional family, I would have garnered myself an ass whipping, you know, from my parents, you know. Like, I knew better to keep my mouth shut, you know. I knew to keep my mouth shut as a kid on that stuff, you know, like, you know, lest the belt come off or a switch come off the tree, you know, like an attempt to beat it out of me, you know, but
wow,
that's pretty much how it was. Like, you know, it's even to this day, like I'm estranged. I'm estranged probably, I'd say estimate 90% plus of my family I'm estranged from because of what I do. And well, accepting the ones that are in the spirit world. Yeah, you know, they support the word. They get it. They get it at that point. But, yeah, the ones still in physical form, yeah, estranged, you know, of the great majority of them. And I'm estranged from a lot of friends, a lot of people I used to call friends. Like, you know, this work has cost me tons of friendships. But, you know, that brings up another thing, Wendy, about the sacrifice that's required of light workers. You know, like there's always a sacrifice required. To make big changes in the world, you also have to be willing and you're required, you know, to go through big sacrifices yourself in your own personal life. And light workers out there who might be listening, like, should be, like, if you don't already know that, be aware of that, that sacrifice is required on this path. But, I mean, how was that? Like, you know, it's like, it's rare when I'm asked that question. I don't think I've been asked that question in a very long time that you asked, but that was excellent there, you know? Like, the, I'm sorry, y'all, those who might be listening, like, you know, just, you know, Wendy hit the nail on the head with that, like, you know, intuitively to ask me that. Like, it's so rare when that's asked to me, and I rarely explain that to people, some of the things I said. So, there. But, anyway, yeah, that's what I do, though, you know. I sit here, and I'm not afraid to make the sacrifices. You know, just recently, yet another friend had to be put to the wayside, so to speak, you know? Like, or, well, they put me to the wayside, be more exact wording there. You know, but did it bother me? No. You know, I'm conditioned to being used to sacrifice. And Wendy's the same way. Wendy and I see the job through to the bitter end. You know, we signed up in this life, you know, to do these things. Like, as spirits, we knew what we were getting into in this kind of life. Like, we were requested to live this kind of life, you know, by powerful beings, you know, you could call them, like in spirit dimensions. And we carry it through to the bitter end. Like, nothing comes in the way of us of doing our life work. You know, that came to me intuitively to say, you know, to keep on emphasizing that the sacrifice that comes with this for some reason, you know. Did you want to elaborate on it? Like, or?
Sure, absolutely. I'll be happy to. And just to kind of share with the listeners as well, for me, when it was first discovered, like, I was born with the abilities and gifts that I have. And when my parents first noticed that there was something very different about me was when I was a year and a half old, and they brought home my baby sister from the hospital. And what happened is, the first thing that I said is, I took a look at her and I said, take her back. She don't work right. And they were, like, looking around, like, thinking, well, you know, maybe she's really jealous and stuff. But they asked, why? What do you mean she's broken? And I was like, she's all brown inside. And I was describing. So I didn't know the words to say because I hadn't yet been taught them. But I knew that there was something wrong with her. And 2 weeks later, she was rushed to the hospital, and she needed an emergency colostomy. And she had Hirschsprung's disease. And so, at the age of 1.5, I knew that there was something wrong with her. I may not have had the medical terminology to say Hirschsprung's disease, but I knew that she was very sick and that she needed to go to the hospital.
And that kind of reminds me of what I said about, like, you know, a few minutes ago about, like, I couldn't verbalize out loud, you know, physically out loud, you know, like, the that I was thinking, like, as a little, like, even a little body, just like an adult, you know, and seeing certain things, you know, and understanding things, like understanding that, like, you know, like I said, sexual terms, cuss words, all of that, what it meant, like, you know, like at 4 years old. And, you know, and that, you know, like it's, and then also, like I said, like I recognize even then that if I spoke about it, you know, I get an ass whipping. So, luckily, Wendy, like, had, you know, her parents, like, you know, for, you know, it was, but of course, it's meant to be, like, you know, the way it was with her parents and the way it was with my parents as well. You know, she had parents that were a little more open in some ways, you know, maybe not all the way, Wendy, you know, right? Like, well, you know, but, like, not, it wouldn't be the same reaction. Like, you got a whole better reaction to it than I would have gotten.
Maybe better than yours. Like, I have never been hit by my parents in my life. And what they tended to do is they were blown away by what my abilities were. And because of that, not that they were open, a little bit open. They didn't share it with any of the other family members. But what they did do is kind of kept me separate. Like, I had a real sheltered life because of it, because they didn't really want me to be exposed to a lot of other people. They were worried, you know, what would other people think? And so although they were loving and wonderful that way, but they kind of kept me a bit secluded, like nobody knew it was a big secret. And I mean, my aunts and uncles, you know, closer, you know, family members, extended family, they did not know. And it wasn't until, like, many years later, like, you know, into my teens, that my own sisters knew, because it was just between me and them. They didn't really want anybody to know. So I don't know if that was necessarily better. But no, I didn't get whipped or beaten or even try to whip it out of me. But, like, when I went to school, the nuns did, because, like, in first grade, my best friend in first grade died mid-year. And when I went into school and I was talking to my friend, like, I didn't know that she died. And then my teacher came in and said that, you know, Renee Gaga has passed away and she's gone to be with God. And I'm talking to her, and so I'm not understanding. And Renee said to me, Wendy, you're the only one that can see me. Nobody else can see me or hear me. And my mom and dad just keep crying. And me, being always like the little, I don't know, wanting to help everybody, I raised my hand to the teacher, like, can't you see her? She's sitting right next to me talking to me. And that's when the nun came over and said, you know, Miss Adams, do you see her? And I'm like, yes. And she took this wooden, you know, pointer stick that was like a broom handle and cracked me over the head with it and said, do you still see her, Miss Adams? And I'm like, I was taught you don't lie, and especially not to a nun. And so I said, yeah, I still see her. And then she hit me again the third time. And at that point, like, I wasn't a fool. That hurt. I could still hear the crack of my head, like, shaking and rumbling from the first two times she hit me. And that was when I said, I'm sorry. Like, no, sister, I don't see a thing at that point. And so, I mean, like, I was really, really different from a really young age. Like, there was a lot of abilities and stuff that I had that were amazing. My dad would always compare me to, like, Edgar Casey because of how, you know, in his upbringing and stuff like that. And he was able to medically diagnose as well. And he did it through channeling, which I didn't do. It wasn't the exact same, but he would always compare me to him.
And, like, for me, like, you know, like, no one knew about this. I never came out talking about this to family, like, until late 20s, do you know? Like, you know, it was, like, mid-late 20s where, like a few people, like, you know, were told, you know? And, of course, and families, like, people talk about one another behind each other's backs, especially in dysfunctional ones. And, of course, word spreads like wildfire with that. And before I know it, you know, like I'm just getting shunned by the rest of the family. They're like, well, you know, you need to forget all that. You know, even, you know, in late 20s, they're like, oh, you know, that's bogus. you know, this and that, like, you know, like you must be mental, and this kind of thing, and like, and that kind of thing. And I told him, well, you know, nothing you say or do is ever going to convince me otherwise. I already know otherwise. And it just brings back, I mean, you know, it comes up to mention this. Like, one of my cousins, you know, like, committed suicide in 2003 when he was 18. And, like, he, and they didn't find the body for, what, 2 or 3 years? Like, he hung himself in the woods. But, and then, you know, I knew what had happened, but, like, you know, I didn't say a word, you know, like, I could see the spirit. But, I mean, like, it, like, I knew at that point, like, it's, it, this wasn't meant to be verbalized yet. But later on, and, like, you know, one of our other hosts on our collective minds, Jeremy Elliott, me and him, like, saw my cousin one day when we were sitting there talking. We're like, well, you know, let's do a video, you know, film ourselves, you know, and on a video, burn it on the DVD, and then, like, give it to my aunt and uncle, you know, of us channeling, like, their son. And, of course, like, them being in the they're so, they were so focused, like, towards religion, in fact, towards Christianity at that point, well, which has changed since then, actually. But, you know, like, so I go over, like, you know, drop out the DVD, and of course, like, beforehand, Jeremy and I knew, like, that they were going to try to write it off, you know, like, as, you know, like, you know, me and him are crazy, and this and that. For, you know, there's no way, and this and that. And, but yet, nonetheless, we did it anyway, you know, because we felt prompted to. And, you know, sure enough, like, and then like, you know, then I get a check in the mail from my aunt for, I believe, $25. And I'm like, well, what are you sending a check for? Oh, that's for the gas that it took to drive out here. You know, and I'm like, what? why would you? You know, like, you know, what's the point? Like, you know, I do what I do for free. I never charge anybody. You know, like, now people from time to time, like, you know, will, you know, on their own throw in, like, you know, out of nowhere send along a check, you know, or I've gotten gift baskets on sent. You know, I don't ask for any of that. It just, sometimes it just happens. I just trust the universe to go along, you know, to take care of me throughout this. And I can tell you, Wendy's the same way on that. You know, we both trust the infinite universe that things are going to be all right. We do our work, you know, we do our life work. We help people and we educate people. To realities they, many people might not have been aware of. One of my favorite sayings is science fiction is often science fact. And another saying that I love, conspiracy theories are often conspiracy facts as well. But anyway, go ahead, Wendy. You know, if I want a little rant there on that. But, like, it just came up intuitively to go into that.
Absolutely, and I just got to apologize because I know there's a lot of noise here. I'm sorry about that. In the desert here, I've got the AC running, and I know that it's kind of on the brink. It was leaking earlier today, so I apologize if there's a lot of background noise. And I think it's echoing, Matthew. When I'm talking, would you be able to maybe mute? I think it's our call. Okay, that sounds better. Thing. I was
just hearing
a bit of an echo.
I don't hear an echo on this side. Like, you hear an echo on your end? Right.
Yeah, I'm hearing a slight echo, a little feedback, and I know that I got a lot of noise going on here too. But you know, I
agree
with you, Matthew.
I think it's more the AC unit. I can hear the AC, the, you know, unit cranking up again. Like,
sorry, guys.
But don't mind that. Like, sometimes things come up. Like I said, we go with intuition on the show, and we're honest about things. Like, I've had shows. Like, I've hosted other shows in years past. Here on Blog Talk and elsewhere, like where people like in the middle of the show I'm being interrupted about like can you put my laundry in the dryer, you know, shouting down the stairs, like, you know, can you mind putting my laundry in the dryer and this and that or that, you know, but we don't mind having stuff like that on the air. That's just real life. That's the things that happen, you know, just like our AC units on the blink. It is what it is. But
that's
anyway,
right.
Like when we got a caller here, like, you know, like you feel we should go ahead with it and see where it goes.
Oh, if you want to, sure.
Yeah, let's go ahead and see. Let's go ahead. You know, and you know, one thing off the room before I answer this, like, you know, Wendy and I decided we do shows together. Like, we're not going to bother with the screening room like that Blog Talk has for callers or stuff like that. We don't even bother halfway intuitively screening incoming callers. We're just going to let things roll the way it is, you know. So let's go ahead and see what's going on with this one. Hello, you there?
Yes, I'm just listening. I like the topic, and I just wanted to hear what you had to say. I have nothing to add.
Okay, you're just listening on. Okay, well, okay, no problem. I'll put you back on the other setting then.
Thank you.
But I appreciate you listening. You know, we appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you.
Sometimes, like, yeah, like we get, like, you know, I forgot about that with Blog Talk. You know, that well, certain calls will come in like that. For listening, you know, that way, where you dial in and listen rather than over the internet. So,
yeah,
anyway,
exactly.
Let's continue here. Like, now, what were you saying before that, Wendy?
We were talking about doing readings for other people, and I do that as well. And, you know, I'm the same way as Matthew. I actually don't charge for the readings. And what I do have right now, though, however, is like an actual waiting list is kind of phenomenal because people are on a waiting list to actually have a reading with me until, at this point, it's going all the way up to September of 2017. So, unfortunately, like that, this is like a one way that you can actually have a moment with me is on if you do call into a show like this that I happen to be on, because other than that, like, unfortunately, you can email me if you go to lightwavesradio@gmail.com, you can email me there. But the waiting list, like I said, is until September of 2017 currently. But I always welcome people if they need help and they need a reading to contact me. You're welcome to do that.
And same with me, like, you know, like things like, except with me, like with readings, you know, like sometimes, like, you know, a wait list will build up, people emailing and stuff with me. But, you know, a lot of the time, like, I'm more of the spur-of-the-moment kind of guy. You know, I like, so many times, like, I've been out, like, going out, hanging out with friends or whatnot, maybe going to a party or just well, something like that, and then it always seems to come up. Somebody is like, well, you know, well, you know, Matt's, you know, intuitive, he's a medium, he could help with this and that. It just comes out. And the next thing you know, I'm to work, you know, and it's one person after another. And there's been times, many times, where I'm walking into, I get out of the car at a friend's house, and as soon as I get out, like a spirit appears in front of me for somebody in the house. And a lot of time, it's like people I don't even know that are there. You know, that they're there for. And I, you know what, I just march right on in the house and launch right into it. You know, turn to even people who don't even know my name. And I'm like, well, you know, there's a spirit here for you, you know, and this and that, and just launch right into it. You know, because it's satisfied just to see, you know what I mean, Wendy, like the, like people's, like totally unexpected something like that. And their mouths drop open when you just walk in, you just charge on in the house, and like, oh, well, your grandma's here, and your best friend who the last year just showed up when I was getting out of the car, and they don't even know you. And then, like, I look at that, right. Like, when that stuff like that happens, you know, and it happens frequently with me, that if that's awakening people. You know, that's teaching people something. You know, that's helping wake up the flock, you know. And I hate to use the word sheeple, but I am, you know. There's plenty of sheeple out there. Like, I don't mean anything derogatory by that. It is what it's just a word. And it's probably one of the, you know, the best ways to describe, like, you know, like people unaware, asleep, you know. And like I like to put it, like there's ones out there, like to analogize it to this, like who analogize it to actual sleep. Some people sleep so hard that you literally, if you have to wake them up, you got to shake them, you know, physically, like, you know, back and forth by the shoulders and yell at them before they wake up. And then there's some people, you know, that sleep so lightly, you know, they wake up with a sound of a footstep or two walking in their room. And you compare that to waking up the masses. Some have to be shaken pretty hard. Some people, you got to upend their understanding of reality, and sometimes, well, as I, the way I always put it is like ways that might seem quote unquote cruel to be kind, you know, like, and it may seem like harsh at the moment to them, like that kind of awakening, but it's necessary. And some people just need a little light awakening, you know, like one little thing stirs up stuff in them, and then they become unsheepled. You know, they take a step out of this matrix here, out of this illusion that reality is. Reality isn't what y'all think it is. You know, it's what people's perspectives of it is. Like mass collective consciousness determines that. You know, would money have any value? You know, if enough people knew for sure it had no value all at once, of course it wouldn't have any value that instant. It would cease to have value except for toilet paper. And that goes for anything. So now maybe that's something we should get into. You know,
no, I don't want to talk about
because the
modern
of light waves is deals with collective consciousness, collective reality as well.
It definitely does, and I gotta say I have a lot softer approach than Matthew does on that. I'm, you know, with people who may not be aware of what's going on and stuff, like I prefer to not put any kind of like a specific label. I just try to accept everyone where they're at, because not everyone, and this has been communicated to me from above, and light beings have communicated this to me as well, not everyone is meant to be awakened. Some people are here to just be human and to have a human experience, and they're not meant to tap into anything more than that. And so I just accept and love people where they're at and just love them unconditionally. But when you're talking about light waves, our motto has always been to spread love and hope to the masses. And recently, thanks to Jewel Crone, kind of put laughter into the mix, and he's a co-host with me again on Night Waves, and we did this show, and it was crazy because, you know, it's a music show, it has nothing to do with spirituality, so if any of you are looking for a spiritual show, that wouldn't be one to tune into for that, because you're not going to find anything spiritual on that show. But what you will find is silliness and bantering and going back and forth and us kind of picking on each other, playing some music and talking about whatever comes to us. And it's been an amazing experience because, Matthew, I've actually decided that laughter is so, so important. I always knew, like, it was amazing, and people have always said over the years laughter is the best medicine. It truly is, and it makes a big difference. So I think it should be spreading love, hope, and laughter to the masses. And I'm sorry, I hear terrible feedback. Is it echoing on your guys' end there, Matthew?
Not at all. Like, I hear you perfectly.
Wow.
You know?
Okay.
So the echoing and stuff is continuing the feedback. Well, I guess we can, you know, ascertain that, like, you know, the cause of that, you know. Well, you know from where. Like, Wendy and I always get interruptions, like, of various kinds, or, you know, when we do shows together. I mean, any kind, like, you know, like we try to do some work. and like we're live on the air, then all of a sudden, like all of my cats will want to be petted all at once. And that never happens, you know, when we're not working.
Well, whenever
you and I
are talking, like if whenever we're on a call, like your cats always come to you too and stuff, but you're right. Like as far as like all of them at once. Yeah, that was crazy that day. I mean, and people should know that, like, Matthew has, like, a ton of cats. He's a big, big cat lover.
And, you know, and speaking of that, like, you know, like, and you know, stuff, like, you know, like, see, one thing I can say, like, see, Wendy does, like, as she said, has a little bit softer touch, like, than I do, like, on things. You know, I'm the kind of person, like, even if somebody isn't meant to be awakened, and yet I feel to say something to them, I roll with it anyway, you know. And yeah, even with people who are meant to wake up, you know, I don't hold back from, you know, even if, like, it comes out, like, that's the brutal truth, it is the brutal truth. I don't, I don't sugarcoat it or try to bring it in gently, that truth. That's just my style. Like, so, you know, Wendy's style, of course, is different, and both styles are acceptable, of course, you know? Like, but, you know, it's just the way she is and I am. You know, we have our different styles of teaching. And, but, yeah, see, like, even, like, you know, tonight, like, earlier on, I have two cats that have gone missing. You know, and I've got, like, well, seven cats, two are missing, you know, as of last week, you know, that, like, two of them went missing. And, like, you know, but, like, tonight, like, see, like, being empathic as well, like, I can sense, like, the other five cats' depression at, you know, at the other two not being around at the moment. And, like, tonight, like, you know, it was like it was being used against me, you know? Like I had to literally shield myself, put up, like, a protective, like, field around me, like, to put it that way, you know, like, to block it out, you know? But, like, it just, I can't let stuff like that be used against me. And not to say I don't care about the cats. Believe me, I do. You know, and Wendy knows, like, you know, like, I respect animals a lot of the time, a lot more than people. So,
very true.
You know, although I'm here to help people, you know, and animals, you know, but, you know, like, I've got way more respect for animals a lot of the time, you know, than humankind. Like, you know, not to disparage anybody out there, but that's just the way it is with me. And another thing is Wendy's got more emotion in it, like, which is fine. Like, you know, like, I've got a lot less emotion on things. Like, I'm, you know, to a fault, I could say. Like, sometimes, like, it's not such a good thing, you know, because, like, yeah, being less emotional, having less emotional feeling makes you more objective, yes. You know, like, it makes you, like, you know, and look, speaking of cats wanting attention, like, I'm sorry, like, you know, the main cat that always does this during radio shows ran in and jumped in my lap and is trying to, like, get on the computer keypad, you know, but I'm not going to let that distract me, you know. All right, but anyway, you know, lack of emotion, like, that way does help. It helps you be objective, but, like, it also kind of, like, puts a little divide in between you and other people and understanding other people, you know? Do you agree, Wendy?
It can definitely, because especially, as, you know, the reason I do function and have so much emotion is because I'm empathic and feeling the emotions of everybody, and I don't block it out because I want to know how people are feeling, and I want to be able to relate to them, and I think that it gives me an edge in the fact that I can actually really truly understand how they're feeling. When you talk to someone, normally you'd have to have the same exact experience that they're having, and if you haven't had that experience, then you don't relate to them, but when you're empathic, you can. just by talking to them and asking them some questions and tuning into them, you can feel what they're feeling, and it allows you to kind of, I don't know, come to where they're at and meet them. And that's where I think it's beneficial for me on doing it. But then there's times too, I agree with Matthew's way, where, you know what, there's some people that, you know, everything in the world affects them, and I mean, you know, they break a fingernail and it's the end of the world, and, you know, and they can be so dramatic. And it's a good way for Matthew to eliminate drama from his life doing that. And there's times that I will do that, but as a general rule, I try to just love and just accept as is, and just go with my heart, what resonates inside.
And see, when I, like, empathically, when I'm feeling other people's emotions, yeah, I feel what they're feeling. But the thing is, with as you know, with me, like, a lot of the emotional empathic feelings I get from others, a lot of them, like, get translated over to not, to, like, I feel it, but I don't understand it, you know, like, in a way. I'm like, because I've told people, I'm like, you know, how simple is the solution here? You're like, I see what you're feeling. You know, you just have to do it. You know, you've got to turn away from this or that person. You just got to just step up and do it. Like, put emotion aside, you know, like, and, you know, and just do what you got to do, you know. And there's other times where, you know, like other people's emotions hitting me, like, becomes, like, you know, my own emotion of anger from them, even when it isn't angry, like, emotions hitting me from people, you know, like, because I guess it's anger in me, like, it gets translated to that, it's, you know, not a, like, comprehending, like, you know, why, like, people don't get it, you know, like, you know, that kind of objectiveness, you know, like, but then again, like, Wendy's way and my way, like, both have their own advantages, you know, I agree on that, you know, like, it's, you know, like, there's advantages and disadvantages, like, I try to tune out emotion most of the time, like, you know, and then when it's, like, when there's an onslaught of it on me, like, on me, like, you know, that's, I guess you could say that's one of my Achilles heels, you know, like, because I just go nuts, like, you know, with that onslaught of emotion from others, you know, like, it just, like, you know, I'm feeling all this, and I'm like, well, you know, like, it just drives me nuts, like, you know, it's hard to take, you know, that, like, from going objective to feeling all that, like, even, like, take, like, because, like I said, animals have emotions, and even, like, tuning in with that is difficult, you know, for me, you know, but, like I said, I'm brutally honest here, like, I'm not mincing words, you know, like, Wendy's right, you know, what about me on that, you know, and I'm not mincing words either about myself, you know, that it is what it is, you know, but the one thing is for sure, she is very, very strong, and I'm very, very strong, you know, in similar ways and other ways as well, you know, dissimilar ways too, you know, but we have strength. That's something I feel to get into, Wendy, that, like, for people who are on the path of light in this life, you know, that, you know, regarding that, you know, like you got to take that strength and you've got to be resilient. You know, you can't let yourself be thrown off the job by distractions. You mean, that's what the opposition wants. You know, anything to throw you off from your work, anything, you know, like, those doing light work in this life, just know that, like, you know, they'll do anything, the other side, you know, to stop it, you know, to throw you off, like, to get your mind thinking about anything but doing the work. I've seen too many people, like, with, you know, too many powerful abilities fall victim, you know, to those tactics, you know, like, you know, everything just getting thrown against them, their children, their, like, children's behavior, what their wife or husband wants, whatever it might be. You know, like, there's all kinds of distractions. Y'all, the greatest defense you know, against being thrown off the path, you know, is awareness. You know, the greatest defense for really not just being thrown off the path by distractions, but really for anything, is always a constant awareness of everything, knowing things to be what they are, recognizing what's going on around you to be what it is, like not falling blind to these things. I just felt Wendy intuitively to throw that in too. So.
Well, you know how I feel whenever we get something intuitively, I live by that, so I would never have a problem with that. And I think that...
I was just explaining it to people listening, that's all, you know? Like, you know, like, it's all about intuition. Like, you know, even as we go here, every word, like, is just, like, based on things that pop in our mind intuitively. And, I don't know, like, it just came to me intuitively again, something about maybe teaching, like, those, like, you know, trying to develop intuitive abilities stronger, because everybody has those abilities within them. That's, except with most people, they've been taught that, like, that stuff is science fiction, not science fact, you know, growing up. And therefore, like, see, like, it's like with children. All children, you know, have intuitive abilities. They're telepathic. And they got away a lot, whole lot more going on. And that's until friends and parents and whatnot, like, and media and schools and other things, like, suppress it in most of them. You know, they're taught, like, oh, that stuff is crazy. They speak of it, you know, like to others, like, oh, well, you know, that's a bunch of lies. That's science fiction. You know, you agree with me on that, Wendy? You're like, it's drilled out, like it's suppressed in people, but yet it can be brought back out, those kind of things, you know? Like, it's inherent in children, but...
It's very true, Matthew, because, you know, we all came here with these gifts and abilities. We came here with amazing, amazing potential, and we were not afraid before we came here. It wasn't until we stepped into a society's fear that we as empathic beings took on that fear and accepted it as our own. And that's an important thing to mention when you're talking about people who are trying to determine what they can and cannot do, is that when you're an empath, you need to be able to differentiate between what you're feeling and what you're feeling in regards to somebody else, what they're feeling, because you don't
exactly.
want to be taking on their feelings as your own. For example, it can be disastrous in a lot of cases. And one of the ways that I always teach people is I teach them to scan their body. Before you're going to come in contact with somebody, tune into yourself while you're alone. Go within. How do you feel in that very moment? Do you feel calm? Do you feel happy? What is your emotion? How do you feel? And, like, study yourself. Get in a practice of doing a scan on yourself. And then watch. When you come in contact with another person, it could just be a stranger. Watch when your energies connect, whether you say hi or whatnot, but once your energies get near each other and your energies merge, how do you now feel? What's different from how you felt when you were alone? And that's a good way to differentiate between what's yours and what's theirs. Because unless something happened to you to affect you between the time that you scanned yourself alone and when you actually interacted with the other being, then what's yours is yours and what's different is theirs. And that's a good way to judge.
And I agree with that. I totally agree. Let me say this, like, you know, like, it comes to me to make the comparison here, like people strengthening their own intuition and their abilities in that to weightlifting, you know, that you sit there, like, you know, like, intuition is inherent in everyone, and most people are suppressed, and some people genetically have it in them, you know, like, to where it's the exact opposite, you know, and it's always going to be out big time and strong, and, you know, but it is genetically present in people, you know, it's one of the powers, you know, inherent, you know, of the soul and the mind, you know, and the brain itself. And, you know, like, it's, you have to exercise the muscle, you know, to make it bigger. And, you know, if a muscle's not exercised, it atrophies after a while. And that's kind of like how the intuitive muscle is. You know, if you don't go with intuition, when you get gut feelings, you know, which are intuition most of the time, like, you know, stuff like that, if you don't go with that, with the information you get without hesitation, like, that's another, you know, that's just another nail in the coffin, so to speak, you know, there. You know, you're just weakening yourself even more, those abilities on that. But if you unhesitatingly go with every little gut feeling, you know, every little intuitive hint that might pop up out of nowhere, the more you're going to get and the more strong that intuitive muscle becomes. And Wendy, of course, you know what I mean by that. It's just like, I like to use that particular analogy of the atrophied muscles, you know, versus, you know, somebody pumping iron, you know, and you know, using those muscles, you know, to developing intuition stronger for whoever might be listening, trying to do that. You still with me?
You know, I agree with you, Matthew.
Okay.
Yes, I sure am. And, you know, people always ask me this kind of a question. I say, well, you know, I know that I have some psychic abilities, and what I want to know is, how can I make mine like yours? And the first thing I always say is, you know, each person is here for a specific path, a journey that's unique to themselves. My path isn't necessarily your path. I was born
sure.
this way, and I began using my abilities since I was born. And, I mean, like, you know, my parents can attest to the fact that I began, you know, publicly saying it out to them and out loud when I was a year and a half. As soon as I was able to understand and speak, I was using my abilities. So I've been using them for a long, long time. And then
that's where the genetic stuff comes in, you know, that genetic
right.
imprint, you know, like, but, like, everybody does have a trace of intuition, at least. It may other things, not so, like, exactly. You know, stuff like when it goes into telepathic abilities and stuff like that, that's also genetic in a lot of ways, and that's not inherent in a lot of people. You know, that. But, you know, intuition, like, always seems to hold somehow. You know, even if it might be weak, it's there. But no, I just wanted to throw that in. Forgive me, Wendy. Keep going.
Thank you. You know, and, like, what I was going to add to that is that, like, I've been using my abilities and stuff that everybody knows of since I was 1.5 years old. So it's a long time of me using it. And what happened to me that really enhanced my abilities, and it's not something that I recommend to anyone, is I was hit by lightning. And I've got to say, I thought it was going to kill me, literally, because my abilities went into such an overdrive that it took me a year before I could literally say I was okay. Nonstop visions. And before, I would just see a few at a time. After being hit by lightning, I would see like 10 of them at a time, simultaneously happening. And everywhere I went, I was seeing, you know, beings that had passed. It didn't matter. And it got to be a point where I would try to hide it a bit, you know. When I'd go out in public, I'd just try not to make any eye contact with anyone so they wouldn't know that I could see them. It was getting to be so overwhelming for me during that time. And people always ask me, Matthew, to share, like, some of the medium experiences. And I don't think I told you about this, but a few months back, I went out to the Outback for lunch. And, you know, we were seated at the bar area, and we order our food, and we're waiting, and the waiter comes over and asks if we wouldn't mind being moved. They needed to do some work in the bar area. And Matthew, they moved us over to the other side of the restaurant, and lo and behold, this huge party's there. Guess what it just happened to be? It was a senior citizen group of widows and widowers, and I was sitting right across from about 50 of them. Could you imagine what my lunch was like, Matt?
Well, your lunch became like a working lunch, basically, you know, like, you know, but I can see it was satisfying, though, you know, like, you know, did you go out and, like, you know, did you come on out and, like, and say what you were seeing to some of them, you know,
you know what?
For
like
our
I
listeners'
was,
benefit here, Or did you hold back?
Yeah, you know, I held back some. I did a little bit, but I held back as much as I could because there were so many. It was so overwhelming that I was just like, oh, my gosh, of all the places for me to be seated. And so I gave a couple of messages, and then that was it. And I just kind of did it discreetly because they were all wanting to, and I didn't have enough time. I had to get back
That's
for a radio show.
That's why I called it a working lunch. You know, like, you could have kept, see, like, I find with myself, like the more, the less sleep I've had, the longer I'm at using abilities, helping people, the more energy seems to come to me anyway. You know, like, my body might feel, exhausted, because using abilities like these drains your physical body as well. You know, it takes a lot out of you physically, as well as mentally. But, I find the more tired I get, the more I go at it, and the longer I go at it, even the physical tiredness is there. Somehow, some way, the mental strength keeps coming back to keep going and going and going and going. But I understand, in a situation like that, where it's a massive group of people, and they're, as you said, they're widowers and widows, and there's a ton of spirits all clamoring to get through to people, recognizing that there's someone there all of a sudden, that can communicate with them and see them. Yeah, I've been through that too, not exactly that many at once, but, I call it spirit nights. I used that term with Wendy a couple of nights ago. Some days, you're hit more with spirits around you than others. For Wendy and I, there's not a day that goes by without spirits being around, not even a month, There's always our guides. There's always, random ones popping in. You go out, shopping, and then you see other people's guides with people sometimes. Ones coming through for people, even in the middle of the store, and in those situations, it's kind of, when that happens to me, I laugh, kind of have a laugh to myself, I'm like, what a wild life this is, getting to experience all this stuff, while so many other people are asleep to these realities. And here I am going through it day in and day out, moment by moment, as you do, and coming back to the laughter thing you brought up earlier. That popped in my mind too, to leave there. Sometimes I have a hard time laughing, but sometimes I do. Sometimes it'll just pour out of me and I'll laugh at my own self, my own life, and other things around me, and I'm in a good way. I'm look at this crazy crap, crazy in other people's minds, of course, not to me, but, and not to Wendy, but, the stuff we go through. I mean, I told her before we could sit down and write, a movie script and write books if we wanted to about what we've seen and experienced in our lives, I've always wanted to do that movie thing too, Wendy, by the way. I've had intuitive friends say the same thing. Well, maybe condense it down to a movie. Put some of this stuff in the movie. It would be fun. I know that's off the subject, y'all, but it just kind of came to me, to mention, the thought of that. But you ever thought of that about you? You thought about that yourself, correct? Well, this would make a great film.
It would
a great novel.
And Matthew, I think you need to laugh. I should share one of the sillier things. It's interesting, Matthew, because as soon as I talk is when that feedback comes. When I'm sitting here and there's nothing around, it's not doing it. But, Matthew, this is a... an experience that I shared on Lightwaves, and I'll share it here because I think you need to laugh. And last year, I went to Las Vegas like I do every July, and the last thing that I wanted to do, Matthew, was a reading for anybody. You know what I mean? It was like, I was only going there for like 2 days, and I wasn't going to be there very long. And so I was there, and I sit down at a slot machine, and there's a woman to the left of me. It's a beautiful, beautiful lady. She's wearing this bright purple pantsuit, and she's got all kinds of jewelry on, rings everywhere. And she's playing the machine next to me. And so I'm sitting down next to her, and I'm minding my own business. All of a sudden, I feel it. You know how you feel like when a spirit comes up, I start to get the tingling in the back of my neck. I can feel their energies getting closer. Then I hear singing in my ear, the song like by War, Why Can't We Be Friends? And so I hear the singing. And now mind you, this woman, her name was Gail, but she's sitting to the left of me. I'm sitting to the right of her at a slot machine. And so I turn, and I'm kind of facing her. She doesn't see Larry's between us. He's got his arm around me, hanging in front of me, singing to me. And she can't see him, but I can. And so I turn, and it looks to Gail like I'm saying this to her. I go, oh, you've got to be shitting me. Because that was the last thing I wanted to do was a reading. And so he says to me, this is my wife, Gail. I have a message for her. And I was like, oh, and at the time I say, oh, you've got to be shitting me. This woman turns to me and she's like, beg your pardon. She's like wondering what's going on here. And so, and I'm like, oh, I'm sorry, you know, and I didn't want to do this. And so then a few minutes later, she gives me this disgusted look because I just said that to her and she leaves. And I'm like, oh, all right, cool. I you know, got out of that one. And about 5 minutes later, she comes back to the same spot. And she goes, boy, I'm just being drawn to this machine. It must be my lucky day. And the next thing I know, I hear him singing again. I'm like, oh, he brought her back. Damn.
Yep.
And so, so I'm like, okay, I'm going to have to bite the bullet and do it. And so I turned to tell her, and I go, and I told her, you know, my name's Wendy. I'm a psychic medium, and I've got your husband, Larry, here with us. And I'm with the comments that I was making earlier were for him, not you. And she's like, Larry, oh, my God, Larry's here. And she's screaming. And, I mean, she's loud. She's got a loud, loud voice. And next thing I know, security for the casino is all standing behind us. We've got 3 security people all over there. And all these people are coming over. And then what happens next, I'm like, okay, well, he wants me to give you a message. And so she's like, oh, my God. And she's screaming. And she's got these long fingernails. I've got to call my husband. And she's dialing on the cell phone. And she's like, honey, I've got Larry here. And she's like, a woman's here who's a psychic medium. She's got Larry here. And she's like, oh, well, I'll find out what he wants. And so she's asking me, and I'm like, okay, so here's the big moment. And I've got, now mind you, I've got an audience of about 20 people behind us, including casino security there. And so I turn to Larry and I say, okay, well, what's the important message? And the important message is, your new man ain't going to get any relief from the roids because I've been hiding the cream. And I'm like, what? And so this is the message I got to tell her. And she's like, well, what? What's he saying? And so I've got to tell her this. And she's like, oh, my God. And she's telling her husband, what's he doing with him? And so I ask him, and he says, tell her to go to the hall closet on the second shelf. And so her husband on the call went and did that. All 20 cubes of Preparation H were in the hallway closet on the second shelf. And he had been hiding them on them.
Oh, man. I love it when things come together like that. Like, but keep going.
And then, gave her the messages and stuff like that. But, I mean, it was incredible. And come to find out, Larry and his wife, Gail, had been married for 48 years, and he passed away a few years back. And after he had passed, she waited about 2 years, and then she actually married his best friend. And Larry was a comedian that used to perform in Las Vegas. And so he's like,
that's
a big
what I was
prankster.
Seeing. Like, you know, I can see the guy right now. He's here now. Like, you know, like, because
yeah.
I saw him, like, as a performer, you know, in Vegas, like, you know, like a show, like a show mm-hmm. performer, like up in
yep.
the, like, a tuxedo and stuff, like, just like
yeah.
that. You know? Like, but keep going. Like, this is how it happens, y'all. Like, you know, the spirits know when you're talking about them instantly. You know, for those who don't know that already, and they tend to show up right away. So, but keep on going.
It was a beautiful thing because he wasn't upset. Like, he was totally happy for them. And I think that's a misconception that people think that if you've lost a loved one here that they would resent you or that you should feel guilty about moving on, because I have never once in all my years of doing readings for people had a spirit come to me and say, you know, Wendy, I don't want my wife to move on. I don't want my husband to move on. They should pine for me. They've always come from a place where it's minus emotion and just love. And love is not an emotion. Love is the energy that connects our bodies to and through from our heart center to our souls. They've always come with love and never jealousy. And they've always wanted to move on. So he was totally happy for them. And he wanted them to know that. He wanted them to know that he really was pulling for them to get together because they were his two most favorite people in the world, and the people that he loved the most. And if he couldn't be there for them, he wanted them to be there for each other. And it was such a healing thing for both of them. And it was amazing. It was amazing to be able to bring like a little bit of a healing to them because, you know, she had been riddled with guilt. Like, I married my husband's best friend. It had been eating at her. And to have his blessing made all the difference to her.
And see, that's a wonderful story. Like, you know, and I can agree with you there. I've never run into one, you know, that said, like, you know, no, I don't want them moving on. You know, like, you know, like, you know, like, you know, well, the only thing I've run into is spirits that come to me, like, well, I've had this happen, that will say they're not with the right person. And I already sense that anyway, you know, psychically about them, you know, like coming through to emphasize that, you know, like, and just like, I guess I'm a sounding board at that point. You know, like for the spirit, you know, when they're saying something like that, that this person isn't meant to be the right person. And I tell them, like, look, and I sense that too, you know, but what do you want me to do about it? You know, like all I can do is pass the message on in whatever way. Have you ever had that happen to you too? Like spirits like that, where it's not a negative thing, but like they know that the new boyfriend or girlfriend is the wrong one. You know, or is using the person, and that they don't realize it, or something like that. You know, like it's not a negative thing. They're still trying to help them out of luck. You know,
I have had that happen, and it's not a negative thing at all. Like our loved ones, whether they're here in the physical or in the metaphysical, are as much a part of our lives as ever, and no matter where they're at, and they still love and care for us, and they want the very best for us, and there are times there will be messages that are not pleasant. And you know what? But I feel it's like my duty to share it anyways, just like you do. I let them know that this is the message. And then I tell them, however, you know what? You are here in the physical. They're in the metaphysical. They can't choose for you. You have to go within your heart and you have to decide for yourself what's right for you. Because anything that we truly need to know is within us when we access our collective consciousness, our subconscious, our conscience. When we just access everything all at once, that's when we're accessing infinite wisdom and knowledge. And we have to trust ourselves more than anything. And we can't just have anybody, whether we're in the physical or the metaphysical, we can't have them dictating our lives. We have to make the choices. We have free will. And you know what? If there's a lesson that needs to be learned, they may be with the wrong person. But you know what? They'll learn that lesson. They'll grow and they'll evolve from it. And that's the reason for it to happen if it does happen that way. So I never interfere. I just share the message as is, exactly the way they say it, even if it's not a way that I would talk. You know what I mean? Like if someone's talking
that's
like
how I do it
you
too.
Know, from the hood
that's
or what
I do
have
it too.
You.
I don't mince words. I speak the way that they say it, you know,
right.
Like in their words, you know, whatever it might be, even if it's like, you know, something the other person's not going to be very happy to hear. That's like as you do. Like, it's, I still say it. Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Right. Yeah, we have to. I kind of feel like it's my obligation. It's something that's like a preference to me because, for example, if I were to change the words when I'm giving a message, it may not come through like their loved one. And one of the most important ways for them to know it is their loved one is to use terminology that they would, in fact, use when they were here in the physical.
And you know what, like, I've got, like, an experience, like, you know, I had, like, like, it's coming to me, like, you know, the spirit, one particular spirit's coming at me from 2013. Actually, this was the summer of 2012, like, when I was doing another radio show here on Blog Talk called Spiritual Science Radio. And, like, you know, on this particular night in that summer, 2012, like, you know, like, something told me, like, just do, like, an open call-in show for channelings and readings and stuff, you know? And then what happened was, at one point, like, this man called in, and then he was, like, a military veteran, a special forces veteran, actually, you know, like fighting combat in Iraq and Afghanistan. And, what it came down to being was that, like, first he was just talking about, like, you know, he never stated some of his experiences in battle and whatnot, you know, until I launched into it, because when the spirit started showing up. And the main one was his CEO, like, you know, like, and, you know, the company commander, you know, and, like, you know, like, and in one particular battle in Afghanistan, like, there was a black dude right to the left of him, you know, like, you know, who got shot in the head during the battle, and then the CO got killed. And then, like, there was a white dude who got killed, too, like, a few soldiers down from him, like, you know, I guess you could call it the firing line, you know, like, their position they had taken up, you know, in battle. And the CO was coming to me saying, look, you know, like, I'm just trying to bring the men back together, you know, I got to reunite the men, you know, and this is all live on the air. And then this call went on, I think it was like 50 minutes, you know, like, while, like, I'm sitting there, like, reuniting them the best, you know. There was one that hadn't crossed over yet, still wandering around Afghanistan, you know. The CO had gone through the portal, you know, and the other dude was kind of wandering around, too. Two had to be crossed over, you know, like, to reunite the company. You know, but, like, you should have seen the guy's reaction. I'll never forget that show. And, you know, like, and the guy had PTSD, too, you know. I said, like, I brought that up. I sensed it, and I'm like, you know, like, because the guy was open. He wasn't afraid to air whatever it was. You know, he wouldn't have called in otherwise, you know, for everybody to hear. And he was already being openly honest about certain things. And I brought up the PTSD thing, and then I acknowledged that. And the next thing you know, like I'm seeing the battle and describing it before he, like, even mentions it. And, like, you know, the guy was just, like, blown away. And, like, we had, you know, that was a rewarding call. I don't know, that came to me psychically to use. I don't know why, Wendy, but, you know, I'm just going, I trust intuition as you do. And that particular call has always stuck with me, you know. Like, you know, like the guy said, like, reuniting, like, he wanted to get the men back together in that unit, you know. Like, you know, the ones, like, who hadn't crossed over, like, needed to be brought back together. They all had to be brought back together. You know, including the guy who called in, you know, is still in the physical. You know, even he, you know, received a measure of healing energy from that, you know, from seeing, from learning that, you know, that his comrades, you know, his brothers in arms are still there, you know, despite not having physical bodies at that moment. Now, that's one thing I just wanted to bring up, you know, going with intuition once again there, that particular call. Like, you know, like, some, like, I see, like, Wendy, like, remember how we talked about, like, how the other night, and you mentioned it here, like, on this particular show, like, as well, that, you know, that the medium stuff and the channeling, like, is for both of us, it's it's more rewarding in a way, you know, like in Vegas, like, you know, like with the comedian spirit, you know, and the wife, you know, like that's that I know that's that was rewarding. I can sense that in that, you know, just like the episode of Spiritual Sides Radio with the guy, with the company commander coming, asking me to reunite, like his men, you know, who had died, you know, like the, you know, and that happened live on air, you know, that was rewarding to me. Like I had another one, like you know, where at a friend's house, somebody was, the spirit suddenly came through. And the spirit of OD on heroin, and like, turned out like that this person's, like the spirit's best friend was sitting there in front of me, like a woman that I hardly knew, and yeah, and she was blaming herself, you know, like saying like, you know, am I faulting this somehow for doing this and that in this case. And the spirit was coming through and saying, no, I did, like, this is all my fault, you know, like the OD, like, I did, like, nobody else did it, you know, it's not your fault that you left for a little while, you know, and then came back, you know, like, nothing happens by accident, and so forth, like, that was another one that felt rewarding, you know, like, it got that guilt. That imagined unnecessary guilt off the woman's mind, you know, that she had been living with for so long. But anyway, though, go ahead, Wendy. Like, jump on there. Like, well, Wendy, you still there?
Okay. Oh, yeah, right. Absolutely. I was just mute in between talking because I know there's a lot of background noise here, and again, I apologize to listeners for that. But, you know,
is
it
still
really rewarding.
Echoing and feedbacking on your side?
Yeah, it is. You asked me a question.
But,
I love it.
But
okay,
on this side, it's not. I don't know why I asked that. I knew it was. Like, you know, sometimes, like, you know, even people like us who trust intuition and go with it automatically will catch ourselves, like, asking, like, you know, is it still there when we already know the answer? You know, to the question. You know,
well, that's the thing. Like Matthew does that, guys. Like, I got to jump in on you for once and interrupt for a moment.
Go ahead.
Like,
go ahead.
If you've noticed, like, what he does when we're talking is, because we're both telepathic, okay, and I think you do it sometimes without even realizing it, because we actually communicate a heck of a lot faster than most people do because we're telepathic. And so he asks me a question, and I'm thinking the answer. He takes it and runs with it. I know, and goes. But you guys don't get to hear me respond. So he's like, you know, and that's one thing that you'll find when you have two psychics together who are pretty powerful. The communication is like that. And so we don't mean to always interrupt each other and stuff like that. And you know what I mean? Like, that's kind of what's happening here. But, like, I just want to remind you, Matt, that, like, they don't always get the telepathy part. So they're not always seeing what
we haven't
seeing.
Addressed that. I only brought it up in passing and not about us. Like, saying, like, you know, that, yeah, remember earlier I mentioned, like certain abilities in mind, like, you know, while all are genetically based. At like at the bottom, at the root, and then so many ways, like certain ones like aren't always in everyone, and now everybody has the capability to receive telepathic communication. Like now, some people receive it and they know they're receiving it, and they know what form of communication it is when they get it. And some people are subconsciously going with it without knowing what it is. And with me and Wendy, you know, among, and we know others like this as well, you know, it's a conscious thing, and sometimes it's subconscious. Sometimes, like we don't even think about the telepathic aspect because it's automatic. And our subconscious is receiving the stuff, and it's coming in, and we react consciously. Sometimes, like, it's so directed, you know, that me and her have had radio shows in the past. Like, but at the same time, both of us are talking out loud on the air. Like, you know, we're also having a telepathic communication about what we're talking about on the air. at the same moment we're speaking out loud. You remember those times, like all those times that happened? Like, you know, I'll say sometimes, like, we're disagreeing on what we should say or shouldn't say. You know, at the same time, we're both talking, you know, physically. I laugh about that now. Like, it's just kind of, like, funny how, like, you know, but Jeremy and I like that too, you know, that, like, a lot of times we'll break out laughing if we're on the phone, you know, sometimes. Mm-hmm. And, like, when it hits us, like, why are we even bothering with a physical device, you know?
Yeah.
You know, like, you know, we both start laughing in the middle of a call, like, why do we even bother? We don't even need a device, you know? Like, Wendy and I are the same way. We don't need any device, you know? But, like, well, tonight we're using the device since we're interfacing with physical stuff here, such as Blogtalk Radio, the internet, whatnot, you know? So it's going to have to be done like that. But the telepathic stuff never stops. And that can be a nightmare. Let me say that. Let me throw this in about abilities like that. You know, and like, abilities like this can be a double-edged sword and are, you know? Like, when... if you're especially, like, certain days you're more telepathically tuned in if you have strong abilities such as that, you know, inherent in you. Some days are stronger than others. And some days, like you're so tuned in to everybody else's thoughts, like, you know, like, you're getting, like, if you're driving, like, a nightmare I've been through countless times is having to drive in, like, heavy traffic. While at the same time, I know how everybody's feeling, all the other drivers empathically, I know what they're thinking, you know, all at once. And, you know, and then I'm having to deal with it. And, you know, I mean, I call it a nightmare because it can be if you let it be, you know, but I just try to balance it out when it gets like that the best I can. You know, now some of y'all listening, like, you know, you're like thinking, you know, well, I mean, how could this be? You know, like, this is Star Trek stuff and whatnot, Star Wars and science fiction. But again, let me remind those who might not be like aware and on this all the way, you know, science fiction is generally science fact. So, like, this stuff is the truth, you know. Like, it's, I know both, Wendy, both of you and I remember the first times, like, we became aware, you know, that we were broadcasting our thoughts out, you know, without knowing, you know, and that people were responding to what we were thinking out loud. Like, you know, you remember your first times on that. Like, I remember some of my first times, like, you know, multiple times, you know, where, like, it's just a strange feeling, isn't it? You know, when the first time, like, you're recognizing that, and then you're thinking questions about people, thinking about people, and then they're responding to what you thought out loud immediately. You know, like, just like they've heard it. Because sometimes telepathic communication, y'all, is like that. You know, when it comes through real strong, you can't differentiate it from a physical voice. It sounds like somebody's speaking to you physically. And then sometimes it's a bunch of images, like with emotion imprinted on images, you know, and words, of the quote-unquote words, imprinted on top of that, you know, and then you get it all at once. And sometimes it's even further. But, yeah, that's a good thing you brought up, that, Wendy. Like, this is a good subject right here. You know, telepathic stuff, because that's a reality again, y'all. You know, just remember that. And I'll let Wendy jump back in there. Right, go ahead.
Can I get the mic for a minute? Woohoo! I'm gonna celebrate here, guys. Okay. Ooh, all right, my turn. And I have nothing to say. Damn.
Like, you see that there's what, like, you just, y'all just saw, like Wendy just talked about before all that, you know, about me and her jumping on top of each other like that, you know, it's due to stuff like that, you know, and then we just did it again. So,
yeah, I thought I had to wait for a minute. Maybe next Tuesday, huh?
You know, but go ahead. And we got a caller, too, by the way, you know, like, just to say that, but go ahead.
If you want to grab the caller, that's cool.
let's see what happens, you know, like, you know.
You want to see what happens?
Yeah, you know, right. Like, I'm not even, like, you know, psychically
anything
thinking
about
the call.
Anything to take that mic away from me. Go for it.
No,
go
but actually, look, do you want the mic first? Like, go ahead.
I'll take it after the call.
This is how
I'll
me and Wendy are, y'all. Like, this is how we are. So.
This is how Matthew is. Wendy shares. Let's get the call. Go
but
ahead,
you
get
take
caller.
The mic first, then we'll take the call. Yeah.
No, I'm good. No, it's more fun okay. To make fun of you. Get the caller. I'm on board.
All right, let's do it. Hey, you there with us?
And you
well,
waited too
not.
Long.
Yeah, well, yeah, that's the way the ball bounces. If they want to call back, they can call back. You know, but actually that was only a 4-minute wait, but I didn't try to, like I said, I wasn't, like, we don't try to psychically, like, we used to do this. You know, I used to do it big time on Spiritual Science Radio. Like, they had so many troll callers, like, at times. Like, you know, that, you know, started having multiple hosts, like, who are also psychic, like, you know, like, looking over, like, the caller queue. Like numbers and reading psychically the numbers and the meaning behind it, using the screening room feature at times, even like, and on the show, I don't give a crap about that, you know? And like, if it's a troll caller, well, you know, trolls calling for a reason, you know? And like I say, you know, the more trolls call in, more disruptors call in to a radio show that's sharing some truths that the other side would rather have suppressed and not widely known, the more you know you're on the right path, teaching what you're teaching on the show. So it doesn't bother me anymore. Like, you know, screw the screening room and having people psychically pre-reading, you know, like, you know, weeding out trolls and disruptors, you know. But, like, go ahead. Like, got the mic, and I'll promise I'll shut up.
I do. All right. I love it when I get the mic. You know, I'm a talker. And, yeah, you know, if you guys want to call in. We'd love to hear from you. And I've got some friends out there listening and stuff and some co-hosts listening. If they want to call in, you guys are welcome to call in. Always love having more people on air with us and everything. You know, and I think the big thing is that, you know, Matthew, think just talking and sharing some experiences is one of the things that I was told from above to really do, that it was important for me to get on the airwaves and get my voice heard and heard by many. And, you know, it has. I've been very, very lucky with that. And I love all the listeners out there, so I got to say I love you guys, and I'm sending love out to you now. But, you know, I think that when it comes to all these abilities and stuff, I wanted to say that, you know, it's amazing to have these gifts and abilities, but they are definitely, like Matthew said, a double-edged sword. It can be a beautiful thing, and it can be so healing and amazing, and I've seen it transform lives. I've seen people who had basically been, you know, overwhelmed by guilt and things of that nature. And, you know, when they get these messages from above, then what happens is that it just opens up their heart, and it allows love to come through, and it's amazing. Just like one little simple message can make all the difference in the world. And to think that these people that, I mean, so many that I've helped now, I've lost count of all the readings. I know that's upwards of like 40-something thousand minimum, and that doesn't count the ones that I've gone in person and done, like you said, out and about, just going to a store and giving a message to someone or, you know, the doctor's
I've lost
office
count
or
too.
The hospital.
I've lost count myself. Keep on.
You know, speaking of the hospital, this is an experience that I should share too. I had been bit by a spider, and I had an allergic reaction. I had never been allergic to anything before, and all of a sudden I couldn't breathe. And so it got so bad that I had to actually call my father and ask him to drive me to the hospital. He was the only one that was, you know, around that time of day because he's retired. And I asked him to take me to the hospital. And so I'm in the emergency room. I couldn't breathe. They gave me oxygen right away, and they were waiting to get me back. And then what happened is this. This woman was there, and she was crying, and here I am on oxygen. Like, I was kind of out of it because of the whole not breathing stuff. I was kind of in and out of my body and everything, and I get this message from this guy, Charlie. He's like, hey, could you please tell my wife that, you know what, that there was nothing that she could do and how much I love her and that she means the world to me. Well, here I am in the middle of choking for air and everything, and she's sitting next to me, so I'm giving her these messages. And she thanked me and everything. And I said, wow, I can tell. It's been really recent. Like, his energy is just, you know, you can tell when a spirit's been gone for a long time or when they're just recently departed. And I'm like, it's been very recent. And I said, I'm so sorry, like, for your loss. And I gave her all the messages. And then I went back and got treated for not being able to breathe and everything. And went on my way. Well, 3 months later, this woman comes up to me and hugs me. I'm walking in the grocery store. She's, oh, my God, Wendy. And she's giving me this big bear hug. And I didn't remember her. I've done so many readings. I didn't remember her at first. I'm, like, trying to figure, okay, like, looking around, like, do I recognize this woman? Because I didn't know who was hugging me. And so she steps back, and I see her face. And I'm like, wait. I go, it's coming to me, Charlie. And you're Kathy. And so, and she's like, yeah. And then what she told me is, oh, my God, Wendy, you made all the difference to me. And she said, the day that I met you in the hospital, my husband had just died 4 minutes before I met you. And, so, you know, I didn't actually know that it had been that quick. And so here I am, you know, telling her all these messages and stuff. And she said, you know, because of you, I've been able to move forward and to be okay. Like, you gave me messages to let me know that he was all right. She said, I don't know if you realize it. Like, it was profound what you did. She's like, I think that you saved me years of grieving by giving me those messages. Like, you made everything better for me. Like, you made my life. You know, you made that. It was such a profound thing that you did. And here I am, like, I didn't even have a clue how profound it really was in that moment. I was a little bit too busy trying to stay in the physical a little longer and trying to do that. But, you know, it's amazing the impact that we have on people's lives. And it is rewarding and it is healing. And I think that that's the most important thing, that when we interact with somebody, no matter what your day is like, no matter whether you have abilities or not, every single person that you interact with, you leave an impression with them, an energetic impression that lasts for all infinity. You can make that moment a beautiful one or not. That's your choice. And I think that that's the key, is to really remember that and to try to understand that, you know what, no matter what kind of day you're having in, that woman, like, that was the worst day of her life. And, yeah, I couldn't breathe in any or anything. And, heck, but you know what? I could make her life better. And that touched me. And, like, I didn't even understand the amazing, profound experience for what it was. For me, it was I was just giving somebody another message. And, yeah, it was healing. That was beautiful. But I didn't actually comprehend the amazingness of it, that he had just died. And that she had been with him that morning. He went to work, got into a car accident. She got a phone call, rushed to the hospital. She got there, he had already died. She didn't get to say anything to him, to communicate with him since the morning. And so every single thing that he had me share with her, it was all handled. It was, like, all done. And the universe works like that. It connects both of us. He's like, I have never had an allergic reaction like that. But there was a reason for me to be there in that moment. I know now, in hindsight, vision is always 20/20, whether we have visions or not. But I didn't even understand it until now. You know what I mean? Like, 3 months after it happened, wow, that was why I was meant to be there. Because that whole experience never made sense to me. I'd never gotten an allergic reaction from anything in my life. And it was amazing.
And see, like, I relate to that, you know? Like, I've been put in situations, like, that at first, I'm like, you know, well, what's the purpose here? What am I doing in this house that with these people? And then, like, they say, I know, like, you know, like, I'm serving my purpose, doing the job of, like, you know, being fulfilled in a way, like, you know, feel that fulfillment like you spoke about, like, you know, that I end up helping, you know, in one way or another, you know, and it's always out of nowhere. And I've got some share of ER stories myself. Like, you know, it wasn't not exactly in the same ways, the same way that it happened as Wendy was talking about with this one. Like, but, you know, all the people that die in the ERs, all right, in trauma rooms, whatnot, you know, like, whenever I step into a hospital, like, especially in an ER area, like, you know, their spirits, you know, who haven't gone through the portal, like they're hanging around the ER a lot of times, you know. And I just remember one in particular from, I think it was 2011, and I was in a meditation, like a deep meditation. Then during the meditation, all of a sudden I went out of body, you know, out of the astrally. And then I'm landing down at MCV hospitals. I'm in Richmond, Virginia, you know, and I'm down at MCV. Well, they call it VCU Health Systems now, but like everybody calls it MCV still, you know, by its old name, Medical College of Virginia. But I was there, you know, in the ER. Like it was two different me's, you know, like one was in the ER with the spirit down there that's been hanging around for years and years, you know. And then it was a separate me up like on the 8th floor, I think it was, you know, in an ICU with two people that were about to die, you know. And it was all at once. And the purpose of it was, once, you know, the people in the ICU had left their bodies, like my purpose being there, you know, was to escort them through the dimensional portal, you know, to higher planes of existence. You know, I was serving, well, I hate to say it, but Wendy, but like, you know, I couldn't say that. You know, I was about to say the Grim Reaper, you know, but that wasn't my purpose there, you know. Like, it was just to escort them, you know. And so there I am, you know. The guy in the ER has a portal open for him all of a sudden, you know. And then, you know, at the same time, a portal opens up for the two in the ICU. And in fact, one of the ICU people, like his brother had already died like a day before. They both had gotten shot, you know, like the brother had already crossed over, had died on the spot, you know. And then the other brother didn't, you know, kind of hung on for a second, you know. And then the other one in the ICU was an old lady, you know. And I knew what was coming as soon as I saw the portal opening up. And one of my guides said, well, you know, do your work, you know, like do what you're assigned to do. And so I did, you know. And yeah, you know, went to the portal and took care of business, you know, like got them through. And the guy got reunited with his brother who had already gone through before him. Like the old lady, like met up with their husband who died before, as well as others. And the homeless guy, like the guy that was homeless who died in the ER, like kind of like a black dude in his 60s, if I remember right, you know, like he met up with some people. But, you know, I just thought I'd relate that one. That one came to mind, like, not to mention all the other times walking in the ERs, and then, like, you know, like I said, spirits everywhere, you know, still hanging on. You know, maybe that's something we should bring up. But we don't have much longer left in this show, but maybe that's something we should touch on, that some hang behind because of unfinished business, you know, and some go through that dimensional portal more readily, you know, quicker. You think we should touch on that, Wendy?
Well, you know, I know you know, but I know. You know, you keep saying, you know, I got to tease you a little. I love you, but damn.
Yeah,
you know,
see, like, you know, that is,
I know, you know, I know,
me,
but
oh,
I know.
That's the matter. I always say it. You know, you know.
Oh,
it
my
just
word, Matthew. If I had a nickel for every I know or you know on this one, I'd be rich before the show's done. I wouldn't need to worry about money, but got to pick on him.
But yeah, see, like that is my habit of doing that. Like, you know, like I don't even realize.
Oh my God!
It, like,
so many habits. Got to work on this, dude. But because like I really have something to say, you know, like, and I really want to share it, but like, you know, you just keep saying, you know, and then you answer the question before I do, like, but it's okay.
It's all good. Go ahead.
Somebody's got to give a shit on it. I know our listeners are feeling that way. Anyway. I got to bring some laughter to the show here. It gets too serious at times. There are spirits who are here, they're earthbound. And whether they have unfinished business or not, a lot of times what I've encountered is that they're afraid. Like the programming, the things that they were taught about crossing over, that they were going to be judged and harmed and stuff, that they're afraid. And that seems to be the biggest thing, fear. I mean, fear is exactly like I said, you know, from the time that we arrive here in this place and we're born into this life, and we're born into the society of fear, we're taught that. And so many people are taught that when you die, that there's this huge judgment thing, and every single thing that you've ever done is going to be held against you, and that's just not the case. And you can take that from someone like me who's had, you know, at this point, 14 near-death experiences. And not once have I ever had an experience that was not loving and beautiful and accepting and unconditional love. And being asked if I will come back because I'm here to help teach and I'm here to make a difference, and that my journey doesn't have to be over, that I could stay, that I could be needed there, but there's so much good that I could do here. And I just want to say that, like, the earthbound spirits do need to be crossed. They're not meant to stay here. And so if you all have an experience with that, you know, I disagree with all these shows out there that are trying to communicate just for entertainment purposes, because you know what? It's not about, like, entertaining the masses. It's about these are souls, and these spirits seem to be crossed to the other side. And it's something that we need to collectively work on, because that energy is not necessary to be here. It affects us in our lives while we're here in the physical, having metaphysical energy that's here that has not crossed to the other side. And there's a difference between earthbound spirits and those that have crossed and come back to visit. And as a medium, you can tell the difference.
And some mediums, like, you know, like for example, Wendy and I are like that. Like, you know, we don't just have to deal, you know, when we come across one like that. Especially, some of them can be troublesome. I'll put it that way. You know, like because they don't understand the big picture, the earthbound ones. A lot of them, not all of them are like that, but quite a few. You know. And I agree with her totally. Like on these shows that are doing it for entertainment, like going out with technological equipment, trying to incite, like something that like incite the spirit somehow, you know, the earthbound spirit, you know, like for entertainment's purposes, you know, like well, you know, that's just earning them, like, you know, a negative energy attack. That's usually what happens. You know, yeah, they're going to get a reaction they keep inciting with certain ones. You know, certain ones who tend to be more negative than others, the earthbounds. You know, but they're just bringing negative energy upon themselves by doing that. It's karma, you know. Like, they're getting what they gave out. You know, they wanted a reaction, they got a reaction. And it might not always be the reaction that they want. And, yeah, for using it for entertainment, I mean, that's idiotic, you know, and that's uncaring, you know. And, but, yeah, there are some, like I was about to say, you know, there are some that, like, that don't have to take bullshit, like, from you know, negative earthbound spirits, you know, still stuck in this, you know, kind of out of, basically they're out of phase. They're still in this dimension, but they're out of phase with this dimension at the same time. You know, it's like, almost like they're cloaked, you know, like, there's a whole other subject, you know, when we have to get into another show. It reminds me of how, you know, like advanced ships cloak, you know, aliens will cloak themselves, you know, but that's a whole other story, you know, out of phase, though. But being out of phase, like, some don't have to take the BS, you know, like, if you come under, you know, like, some of us, like, we make them go, you know, when when the situation necessitates, you know, like, you know, there's some of us with the ability to like force them through, you know, for the greater good, for their own good. You know, these days, like personally, I shy away from that a little more. I try to be more compassionate, more understanding, even with the ones that are extremely negative. But if like a spirit's there, and you know how this is, Wendy, some of them can be a problem. You know, like these are some of the earthbound spirits. Some of them really can be. And sometimes you just got to do what you got to do. And you take them through the portal whether they like it or not. Now, some of y'all might look at that like it's, you know, a violation of free will, which in a way I guess it is. But the way I look at it, though, personally, is that if it's for the greater good of them, to help them in the end, help them get like get to a place of understanding of things, like then, you know, it's not so much like a free will violation, you know, like you're doing it for the greater good of beings that they're affecting through their energy, and you're doing it for the greater good of them. And you know, you see what I'm saying?
Oh,
I just
I
thought
see.
I'd touch on that.
Yeah,
you know?
Definitely.
Like,
I haven't really had any kind of people have asked me this question, you know, have you ever encountered a spirit that scared you? And no, because karma.
Same here.
Karma, yeah, and I can even know that unless you consent to it, you're not going to be harmed. You know, you have to be strong, you have to protect yourself. And whenever you're dealing with, like, I've had people ask me to come and do a cleansing on their house, and I had never actually done it for anybody else, you know what I mean? But it was interesting because it was actually the woman that did the financing paperwork when I bought my car, and she asked me to come to her house and to do a house cleansing. And I was like, well, I really don't do this. She's like, well, I'll pay you to do it. I'm like, no, like, if I'm going to do it, I'll do it for free. I don't charge people. And like, I'm like Matthew on that. Unless someone offers to donate or something like that, I don't demand it. I don't only help people if they'll pay, because I'm not about money. And so I agreed to go to her house and do the cleansing for her. And she had her great-grandmother, her husband's great-grandmother there. Because the first thing I walked in and I'm like, I could feel the energy, the house. You can, like, when you've been doing it as long as I have, like, you can feel it before you're even in the house. You're on the way, you already
exactly.
know what's going on. Like, you knew, I already knew that there were three spirits occupying that dwelling. And the first time that I walked in, and I'm like, okay, who's Beatrice? And, like, I had never met her husband. That's, like, the first thing I say, who's Beatrice? And he's like, Beatrice? And I'm like, yeah, it's a connection to you. And he goes, that's my grandmother. And he's like, he's like saying to his wife, did you tell her my grandmother's name? Because he had been away on business and didn't even know I was coming. But she was scared to death to be in the house because he goes away on business trips all the time. And she's left alone and she's hearing all these noises and she was getting quite scared. And Beatrice was there. And what I did is I basically helped them clear the spirits out of the house and everything like that. And every single time, it's just been a question of communication and understanding and just trying to love them through to the other side. And I try to do it in a gentle way so it's not forceful. And I understand what you're talking about. There could be times when you have to be a little bit more forceful. But for me, I haven't had any experience where I couldn't talk to the spirit and I couldn't convince them that there was going to be love on the other side and they were okay and that it wasn't going to be a judgment like you've been taught. That was not the truth. And so fortunately, like, I haven't had to have that experience where I've ever had to force the spirit through. And I'm glad because that's not me.
Multiple times. Like, you know, like, it's usually only when, like, they prove to be such negativity where, like, it's thrown off my own concentration, you know, or, you know, in situations where they try to attack me using directed mental energy. You know, like, I don't feel like tying myself up in battle, you know, in those situations either. You know, that's a waste of time, like, you know, to attack back. You know, like, the answer is, like, you're fortunate, though, not had to do that. I've done it hundreds, of, maybe even thousands of times with spirits. But like I said, I'm more lenient these days. I'm more like you. Like, I'll sit there and try to talk to them, you know? Like, remember that, like, that young dude, Day-Day, like I was talking about the other night? Like, who died recently around Richmond? Like, and I knew I could have put him through the portal right then and there, if need be. But, you know, like, instead, like, you know, I'm like, well, I'm going to be lenient. Not lenient. I'm just going to be hands off on the here, you know? Let him sort things out, you know? Like, you know, and then when he's ready, like, you know, if he needs some help, I'll help, you know? Like, a few years ago, like, you know, he would have been put through the portal immediately, you know? Like, you know, it just... See, like, you know, like, as we talked about, like, Wendy and I have different styles on this, you know, like, things like this and other things, but, you know, I can be more forceful, like, you know, like, on stuff like that, you know, and I'm learning not to be. I'm learning to have, like, how do you put it, Wendy? Like, softer
some boundaries.
Touch. Boundaries and... softer touch. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know,
love
like
the way.
Because like having no bounds like is like opens you up to doing a lot of things, yes. You know? But like you know, when you indiscriminately or you have no bounds, you know? Like you know, the slightest annoyance results in this and that. You know, from a spirit or whatever. You know, like then you gotta check yourself. You know, like at a point, you got to get yourself together. I've been trying to do that, working on that. So, but just wanted to touch on that, though. You know, it's just like so much responsibility comes with the work, like beings like Wendy and I and others of our own soul group, and soul groups that work with ours as well do. You know, like it's with great. Power comes great responsibility, and you know I felt to say that term too, Wendy. You know, just came to me to say that. The great power, you get great responsibility as well. You got to wield power responsibly. You know, can't let like you know certain things get in the way of being responsible. You know, so. You know that. You know, I've been the one, like, who's over the years, like, who's indiscriminate, like, you know, blunt to the core with people, like, you know, lacking the soft touch, you know? Like, lacking,
I do know.
That.
I definitely know. Like, so you kind of evolved a bit. I got to, like, congratulate you on that, because I know that one of the last conversations that we had about that, you were a little bit upset with me for me not being brutal enough, and I remember that, and so you have kind of softened a bit over the years, and like I got to say I'm proud of you for that, because I know for you, that's huge, that's a huge evolvement for you, and like the listeners need to understand that when you do have these kind of things going on in your life every day, it's amazing. It is an amazing responsibility. I have to agree with you on that. But, you know, there tends to be some people out there that kind of abuse the abilities that we have. And I love that, you know, you don't do that, you know. And I love that you're taking a softer approach towards things and not just, you know, pushing your way through every single thing. You're kind of reflecting a bit more with your heart. So that's a beautiful thing.
I try my best, you know. Like, you know, I do a lot better than I used to. Like, I mean, just a mere, like, 3-4 years ago, like earthbound spirit comes around me, you know, that's even slightly negative and it's throwing me off even for a second. You know how quick I'd be. You know, you remember that, you know? Like, just how quick I was even a few years ago, even at, like, the slightest little provocation. You know, like, you know, it's time for you to go through the portal, like it or not. And then, you know, all of a sudden I'm out of body and making it happen. And, you know, yeah, these days, like, yeah, it's a hands-off approach. a lot of the time. I like that. Like, you know, and you're right. Like, I'm trying to be more loving. I'm trying to be more understanding, you know? Like, and then, like, something that it comes to me to say, too, to our listeners here is that in spirituality, like, you know, there is such a thing, you know, as you can be spiritual and hardcore in a way at the same time, you know? Like, there is, like, you know, a cruel to be kind component to this. You know, it can happen like that. And it doesn't mean you're not loving. You know, it's just, a lot of it's, like, based on past life memories, past life resonance, as it is with me, you know? I mean, I come from a long line of negative past lives. Not all of them, but plenty of them have been. And, you know, we all have gone through that. Not every lifetime we've lived has been the very best. You know, and that goes for everyone. You know, everybody's fucked up before. Everybody's had fucked up past lives. You know? Like, some, yeah, some went great, and then some went straight down the ship. You know what I mean, Wendy? You know, of course you do. But, I mean, like, to our listeners, you know, in the last few minutes here, you know?
Right.
Like, just remember,
yeah.
Like, you know, learn from the past. Like, and remember, like, that past lives, like, are, like, you know, there's no such thing as time. I call them past lives just out of convenient wording. You know, like, for people to understand, there is no time. Like, past lives are still being lived right now. Future lives, quote-unquote future lives, are being lived out right now. Potential lifetimes that you may or may not come up to and live out are being lived out. You know, it's all going on at once. And remember that all the knowledge from everything you've ever lived is already within you. And since all of us as spirits have always been eternal, we're not created. We've never been created, and we can never be destroyed, none of us. That means we've done everything. And therefore, if we've done everything, which all of us have, everything's within you, as Wendy said multiple times. Everything's already there. You know, the wisdom of the ages, the knowledge of the universe exists in all. And, you know, I thought that just important to say in the last couple of minutes, too, you know? Like, you know, just to remind them that there is hope out there. You know, there's nothing to learn, there's nothing y'all have to learn, nothing. You know, there's only stuff for y'all to remember. Keep that in mind, too. And I'll,
absolutely.
Like, Wendy, like, Wendy's got the final word here. We got about 2 minutes here.
Yeah, definitely. You know, I always say to make your words and your actions come from your heart center. And to truly, definitely go within, you know, listen to everybody out there, but then take that information and go inside your heart and truly decide. And that's the most important thing that we need to share is, you know, hope, love, and laughter. And there's so many changes that are coming in the world, and we really need to come together as one to face them. And we need to be united, and we need to love each other. That's kind of my message is always going to be that love. It's never going to change because love is infinite.
Indeed, you know, and we titled this episode like the spiritual aspects of world events. Like as we said, like intuition took us another way, and now on future shows we might get into some of this stuff, you know. But intuition took us another way tonight, but that's all right. Everything happens for a reason. But we're down to 1 minute here, so we're going to go ahead and sign off here, like on this
all
one.
Right.
Like, I mean, this has worked out well, Wendy. Like, we did well, you know? And I hope that all of y'all listening understood, you know, and I hope y'all gained something from this. And, again, like, you know, thank you for listening. And Wendy and I both hope you join us next time.
Have an amazing evening, everyone.